Bills, bills, bills. How am I ever gonna pay for all of these bills?
Why not become an overnight millionaire?
But how?
Why not do it the old-fashioned way? By becoming a Hollywood screenwriter.
That's right. I'm Tom.
And I'm Ben. And our screenplays have made over $1.4 billion at the box office.
And with our patented screenwriting system, you can turn your worthless dreams into cold, hard cash by doing it the old-fashioned way.
By selling out in Hollywood.
Hello, hello, hello. This is On Books, and my name is Chris Castiglione. If you're new to On Books, well, hey, welcome. Sit down. Hey, take a seat. Hey, glad to have you here. Just want to let you know that if you've never read the books on Books, like this book here, that's cool. You're welcome. You know, that's why I'm here. I'm going to give you some of the highlights, some of the summary of the book, as well as have a conversation about it so you can get, you know, a little bit of the context around the book and how it applies to real people like me and you, assuming you're a real person. If you have already read the book, well, you're going to do great on the test at the end. Just no brown nosing until then, all right? So today's book is Writing Movies for Fun and Profit, although fun and is crossed out. So it's basically, I guess you call it, Writing Movies for Profit. It's by Rob Grant and Tom Lennon. You may know them from MTV's The State, or more likely Reno 911, although MTV's The State was amazing, probably my favorite show ever on television. And they started Reno 911 after that. Tom Lennon, he is also really well known for the character he plays on Reno 911, Lieutenant Jim Dangle. As you heard in the trailer for the book, which was up front and is hilarious, Rob and Ben went on to write movies. They're screenplayers. Is that how you say that? Screenplayers? Probably not. And their films have earned over $1.4 billion at the box office, so a lot of money, to which they thought, hey, we know a lot about screenwriting and making money. We should write a book. And I'm really glad they did, because it's one of the most concise books on screenwriting and film that I've read. I've read probably about a dozen or so movie books, books about film, books about screenwriting. And I also want to say that, hey, if you're listening and you're like, hey, I don't want to write a screenplay, I think I'm going to skip this episode, I want to say to you, I found a huge amount of just appreciation for film and how films are made from reading this book. This one, I would say, compared to all the screenwriting books that are out there, because it's so concise and because the language that they use is so, it's not a parody, but there's some pretty satirical bits all throughout every sentence of the book. So the reading it is really, really fun. And I'm going to read a little bit in just a second to give you a taste of that. So like I said, I'm in three parts today. The first part, I am going to read to you from the book, give you some of my favorite chapters. The second part, that'll be a quick part. I'm just going to talk with Zach Valenti. He is part of the Wolf 359 podcast, and he dropped by to give me some bits of knowledge related to the book. He couldn't stop talking about it, and I love that. And in part three, I will have a discussion with Sydney Flint, who, her and I are, and this is going to be revealed, are working on a web series together, and we are writing that. Hence, me thinking about this book and putting it in front of mine and her face. So that's how we got here. And I'm really excited to have that chat with her and share that with you. So if you're ready, we're going to turn your worthless dreams into cold, hard cash, according to Tom and Rob. Let's do it. The book is divided into two parts. The first part is called Selling Your Movie. The second part is called Writing a Screenplay. I'm going to read from chapter two, which is about selling, and I'm going to read a little bit from the second half of the book as well about writing. So this is chapter two. It's called Why Isn't Anyone Buying My Brilliant Script? And I'm going to skip around a little bit. So rule number one from here, no one wants you to reinvent the wheel. Let's put it this way. Do you like movies that challenge and confuse you? We do, sometimes. Eraserhead is great, but not every night. Can you take your in-laws and their kids to see Eraserhead? Can you pop Eraserhead into your Blu-ray when your family is over for Christmas to shut everybody up for 2 hours? Can you give a DVD of Eraserhead to your folks on their birthday? Don't get us wrong, we love Eraserhead, but 95% of Americans, if you forced them to watch Eraserhead, would want to punch that movie in the face. It would punch you in the face for making them watch it. If you want to make movies like that, make an indie. Make a movie with people who don't care about box office receipts. Rule number two. Most people do not go to the movies to be challenged. They go to the movies to be entertained. Of the writers we know who haven't been able to break into the business, a lot of them think they can break into the movie business by writing a script that breaks all the rules. Quite the opposite. Follow all the rules to the letter. The other reason that your brilliant screenplay that you've been talking all over town about isn't selling is just because, in big letters, don't hang your dreams on one brilliant screenplay. Period. We know a few screenwriters who've tried this because when their one screenplay didn't sell, they kept tweaking it and honing it and rewriting it based on whatever feedback they got from the last studio, or studio that passed on it. In big letters, this is a big mistake, one of the biggest. So that's a little bit from chapter two. And the main takeaway, if it wasn't clear enough, is always be writing, keep writing more. Don't just have one script, don't just have one prize project that you're working on, keep working on it. If your first script doesn't sell, make another and another and another and just keep working. All right, I'm going to skip to the second half of the book here. This is chapter 23, and this is called If Your Screenplay Doesn't Have This Structure, It Won't Sell. Or, also titled, Robert McKee Can Suck It. So, a little bit about Robert McKee, just in case you don't know. He wrote what is known as like the pinnacle book of story writing, of screenwriting. It's called Story, S-T-O-R-Y, just one word. And if you haven't heard of the book, if you've seen the movie adaptation, it's quite popular because he is a character in that book. He is the guy that Charlie Kaufman goes to visit in New York City to get help with screenwriting. So anyway, maybe that jogs your mind. But otherwise, he's a good name to know, a great name to know whenever you're talking about screenwriting. He's like the guru dude. So just a little side note there, because it comes up a lot in this book. Chapter 23. Every single Hollywood studio movie has the same structure. From Casablanca to The Matrix, there are many, many books explaining the structure, and we have no idea why you'd need to read a whole book about it. Okay? So here it is. Every studio movie has three acts. Act 1, you get a likable guy stuck up in a tree. Act 2, you throw rocks at him. Act 3, you get him down out of the tree. That's it. Aliens will arrive on Earth, they'll kick our ass, we kick their ass. Bruce Willis gets stuck in the Nakatomi Tower. He gets the shit knocked out of him. He throws Hans Gruber out of the Nakatomi Tower. 1, 2, 3. That's basically it. Now, within those pages, things always go down like this. And it's this part of the book that they break down page by page what you need to expect when you're writing and watching films. So, studio movies, to be specific. So, pages 1 through 10, we meet your hero and the world he or she lives in. So that's the start of your movie. Welcome to Kansas. Here's Dorothy. She wishes she wasn't in Kansas. That's it. Try RoboCop. Ready? Welcome to Old Detroit. Here's Officer Murphy and his creepy high-tech world that they're looking for KAA cops, blah, blah, blah. This is RoboCop. So if you haven't created a character or situation that could be explained in 10 pages, it's wrong, and they'll repeat. If you've created a character or situation that can't be explained in 10 pages, you are wrong. It is wrong, okay? That's what's going on. It continues by going to page 10. You need to have an inciting incident, and they break down what that is. Page 25, your hero is launched into the story. Around pages 45 to 50, that's when things get worse. Page 70 to 80, things can't possibly get any worse. Pages 80 to 90, you show the audience that winning is going to be even harder than we thought it was going to be. And 90 to 100, woo, the climax. Your hero wins. That is every story in Hollywood. In the final pages, you may have something where the hero walks off into the sunset, or James Bond screws Dr. Goodhead on a raft, blah, 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 blah. But the point is that by the end of the story, the world has been changed for the better by your hero. This is the most important part of writing a screenplay, according to Tom and Rob. And they say, this is the structure. You must always use it. Always. Chapter 25, I'm just going to read a short bit here from How to Write a Screenplay. So they say, enough bullshit. Now you're ready and you're going to sit down and write the screenplay. Great. Go put on those fruity carpal tunnel syndrome gloves if you know it's good for you. Here's the big secret no one tells you writing screenplays. It's easy and fun. Fun's crossed out. And why is writing screenplays so easy and fun with fun crossed out? Because writing outlines is hard and time-consuming. Repeat this mantra to yourself in a Yoda voice. There is no writing screenplays. There is only writing outlines. If you write a good outline, the screenplay will write itself. So the point of this book here, and this is going to come up in my conversation later with Sid, is that you shouldn't sit down and just start writing the dialogue and start getting into that. You need to have structure and you need to start with the outline. So this book, Writing Movies for Fun and Profit, it's around our office. There's a few copies, and I think about like half of us here have read it, and we joke about it a lot, and it's been a lot of fun. And so a few conversations have come up in the office, and I'm going to speak with Zach, who I work with here at 1 month, and then a little bit later, Sydney. I just started off this conversation with Zach asking him, you know, why do you love this book so much? And he replied,
I love the 30,000-foot view, like the idiot-proof guide to story structure that they give you, where they're like, look, you can read 800 pages and like seven of those books to get story structure, or you can read this paragraph, this like sentence. Take a guy, a likable guy or gal or whatever, you know, take a human being that you like, put them up a tree, throw a rock at them, and bring them down.
So that's one of Zach's favorite takeaways. And I read that bit for you up front, so you should have been a little bit familiar with it. Him and I, we had quite a bit of a conversation that day. And he studied at Wesleyan, which I'm slowly finding out seems to be one of the top schools for making filmmakers, because I keep meeting so many amazing people in New York City, and then I'll find out where they studied and they're like, oh yeah, I was at Wesleyan. So it's becoming a little bit of a trend here at the office as well. We have three Wesleyan grads here working in our film department. Zach also works on a podcast called Wolf 359. It's a sci-fi drama on iTunes. You can download it. So him and myself and the episode editor for this episode, Gabrielle Urbina, we chat around the office a lot about story and writing story and story structure. And as we were talking about this book, Zach quizzed me with this question, and I loved it and want to share it with you.
If you just want to tell a story with people talking, like you could write a play. So what makes it, you know, inherently cinematic? And this is Janine Basinger all over. It was like in 10 minutes, she blew away, you know, like 20 years of education.
Who is it?
This is the woman who created the film department at Wesleyan, who's of the leading cinema in my world. She's like the number one film professor. And she broke down what it, you know, so I'd ask you, like, what do you think is the, like, soul, if there's one thing, what is like unique to cinema?
I love the question. Is it unique to cinema versus a play specifically?
Unique to cinema.
Unique to cinema.
Period.
Got it. I think with film, I mean, there's so many things, right? I don't know. There's so many things. There's voiceovers, you know, that you could have, and there's scene changes, and there's, you can go through time, you know, in a way, but I guess you could do that in books as well. And imagery, I think, is really important.
Paintings.
Yeah. I think there's a lot that you can do with a scene.
You're onto something with changing scenes and time. What about that is unique to cinema?
You can edit the scenes in time.
Really? Yeah. Basically, it's the cut.
Yeah, the cut. Okay.
Because, you know, basically film is every other art form rolled into one. It's composition. It's acting. It's dialogue. It's light. It's all these things. You know, photography, painting,
the
theater.
Because in plays, you can't cut.
It's the only thing that you can only do in this medium, which is break time and space.
Yes. I guess you could do it with a book, but not with images, like the way that you do with film. I mean, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
I see what you're saying. That's amazing. Yeah.
And so, and that piece gives you, you know, the, and it's not just with between scenes, it's also within a scene, you know, your ability to cut immediately from a wide shot to a close up transforms what you're, you know, what your viewer is getting.
Yeah. Do you think that, because like clearly movies have an emotional impact, whether it's laughter or, you know, sadness or any, some kind of reaction. Mm-hmm. Is it that like ability? How is that different than a play? Like, you know, because I feel like with a play, there's a lot of emphasis on dialogue.
Yeah. Maybe. Well, and this is what I would just continually ask of myself and of anybody. It's like, treat yourself like the experiment, you know, so put yourself in the seat of a theater. You know, you could be paying attention to the grip whose hand is coming on, you know, is like holding on to a rope, or, you know, somebody off stage, you know, there's like
at a play.
At a play, your attention could be anywhere.
Yeah.
Similar in a movie theater, but less so, you know, if you're like watching Netflix at home. I think of film as basically like a magic trick that you pull on somebody's nervous system through their eyes and ears in a way that theater isn't, as you know, to the same degree. And it's not better or worse, it's just different.
I see what you're saying.
Where like you can do things to a theater, you can do things to a film goer that you can't do to a theater goer.
Like force them to look at
exactly.
For a Dream, the dude's eye, or
yeah, exactly. Or you, like you have
intense scenes, you can't look away.
An intentionality and control over people's attention that you don't in other narrative medium.
No, that makes a lot of sense. And do you deliberately think of that when you're writing, you know, coming back to screenwriting, or do you think about like how do you, I don't say exploit, but how do you like use that to your advantage for as an art form?
Well, there's a bunch of interesting, you know, parts of that where, you know, when I write a screenplay, I'm watching the movie in my head and then doing the best job I can to capture it in words in a way that doesn't offend a director. The worst thing you can do when you're writing a screenplay is put in a shot description. If you're trying to sell a screenplay, if you're the director, if you're Woody Allen, go for it, dude.
Yeah.
And I would be surprised if he even does it. You know, it's like one of those things that's like, if especially if you're writing it for somebody else, it's like, it's a dick move to like put in like...
What is the shot description though? I mean, if somebody's going to be in a car, you're going to say they're in a car, right?
Yeah, and that's different from close up on the dashboard.
Oh, I understand. I understand.
And there are ways to subtly do it where you can say like the numbers on the dashboard like race higher and higher and higher, you know.
Got it.
So like it's you find a way to do it artfully without being like overly prosy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wrote this scene that I was in love with and I submitted it to a contest and they were like, you know, it was like this description of the like alien dunes move in the night and turn and like basically it's like slowly moves back, it's like very poetic and it slowly moves back and it's like sheets and there's like somebody sleeping and they're like, that's beautiful in a novel, like just tell me she's sleeping and like that like the sheets are moving up and down and get the hell on with your scene. And I was like, oh, okay.
And it seems like that's like what an art movie would do though, if you were,
but
like potentially,
but you know, but like, that's the thing. If you're the director and you're writing your own screenplay and that does it for you, great.
Yeah.
If you're trying to write a screenplay that you have no intention of shooting, be practical.
Mm-hmm.
And like, they'll shoot it how they want to shoot it and focus on telling a story where characters are communicating through action and reaction.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
All right, thank you, Mr. Zach Valente. So I will now direct your attention to this next conversation that I have with my writing partner, Sydney Flynn. And I say writing partner, although we haven't written anything yet, but we have an idea which we are both in love with. We want to tell the story of startups, we're the world of which we live in New York City. And we want to tell it in a kind of high fidelity beats Silicon Valley kind of way. Not as campy as Silicon Valley. Or let me try that pitch again. Maybe it's a little more like Girls meets The Social Network. We're still working on it. Again, we haven't written anything yet, but we've given ourselves a deadline, and as you'll hear in the conversation, and we are working on the writing as soon as we finish this chat. So there's more to come, but that kind of sets up the premise for why we are talking, and you'll hear a little bit of that about that in the conversation.
It's page 204.
Oh,
it's called Am I Drinking Too Much?
Oh, here it is. I'm drinking too much. Is that a problem? The short answer, no. The long answer, nope.
So funny.
Yeah, it's amazing. And then they go on to give examples of Hemingway and Oscar Wilde and all the great drinkers in history and how you want to be like them. But there is some really great advice in here and some really inspiring things. I have just a few things jotted down that really kind of hit me. Did you kind of have a few things too? Do you want to just chat a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
I don't know. I think I was kind of fascinated about how Hollywood works. I mean, to kind of just go there first. There's a lot of money in writing a screenplay, and that's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Did you know that already? I mean,
no, I didn't. I didn't realize how much money is just poured into a film.
Poured.
Even films that are kind of like mid-level or like.
Yeah.
It seems a little excessive and insane. And there's no, I don't know. I feel like they should take like a project management course or something.
Yeah, like we do here at One Month. Yeah.
And really streamline their process and they save a lot of money.
You think it sounds kind of messy. Yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. So, and I guess kind of leading into it. So like, you know, Ben Grant and Tom Lennon, the guys that wrote this, have you seen any of the movies that they've made? They made
Night at the Museum, which was actually pretty hilarious. I thought it was for kids.
I think it's made the most money out of any movie in history.
Yeah.
It's like one of the top 10 lists of that. And they have this movie Herbie, which I haven't seen, which is Lindsay Lohan that they make, which is apparently a huge flop, according to them.
Yeah, they call it like a Hollywood horror story of all the worst things that can happen to your script once it gets made into a movie.
Yeah, that's kind of the point that we were just making about like all the money that gets poured into these things, because on that movie, they wrote the original script, but there was 24 writers on that movie. And they talk about how you'll come and they're like, you just have to get used to getting fired. And if you get fired, it's a good thing. Do you remember that part?
Yeah. And then oftentimes you get rehired.
Because you get like rehired. And it means if you're getting fired that they're hiring someone else. And it means that they're going deeper into the money pit and that they really want to make this good. So it means eventually, because I think if it doesn't matter if your writers 1 through 24, like you're all going to get paid basically. And so.
Right. It just seems insane too.
It seems insane to put that much.
All the things. They like hire you and you write it and then they hire other people to revise it for fresh eyes, quote unquote. And then oftentimes the fresh eyes don't go so well. So they rehire you again. But that's not the end.
Yeah.
It keeps going. And oftentimes, like if a big name actor signs on, they come and they bring their set of writers like write.
And they do a little pass.
They do a little pass. And then oftentimes the director comes in and they have their writers.
Yeah. It made it sound like if you have a good idea for a movie that basically it could possibly get made, you could make money, and it's just going to be crap at the end of the day.
Yeah, like it'll never, no matter what you do, unless you're the writer, director, and star,
basically,
the movie will never, or you're Wes Anderson or something.
Yeah, or like Lena Dunham or something like that.
Right.
Yeah. It's pretty insane. Like I just had no idea how many, there's a whole few chapters on here about all the different credits that they have and how it's like screenplay by or like narrative. Yeah, there's like so many different ways that they carve out. It's just like, it doesn't matter who wrote it. They're just going to throw all these people at it. It was kind of enlightening and crazy. The minimum amount that you could make on a screenplay, it said it was $100,000. So basically $100,000.
Oh, I don't remember that part.
Yeah, it's like the minimum. So they're like, even if your movie's a flop, even if it doesn't get made, they buy them at $100,000, which seems like it's pretty good living, man, if you make a...
Yeah, and the even if you're, I was so fascinated to hear about how writers who are hired just to do some rewrites we're paid like $10,000 a week.
Yeah.
And you don't even have to be anybody in Hollywood. You don't have to have any names. You don't have to have any movies under your belt as a writer.
Yeah.
But if you kind of get in with the right crowd, so to speak, by it seems like keeping your head low and being very agreeable, then you'll just get these writing gigs.
Totally.
They downplayed it, but $10,000 a week is a lot of money.
Yeah, that's a lot of it. It's just like...
It's crazy to me, but...
Review a script.
Mm-hmm.
So you and I, we've been talking. I think one of the reasons why I was like, hey, you should read this book is because we've been like writing or thinking about writing, I should say, scripts. Would you say that we're in the writing or the thinking about writing stage?
I think that we've been talking excessively about writing.
Whose fault's that?
Like mine?
No, that was my fault. But oh. I feel like a little
I don't know. Is that a trick question?
I don't know. I just thought, I feel
you
like.
You looked very accusatory just now.
Well, I feel like it was like a guilty look.
Because you were accusing yourself.
Yeah, I was accusing. That's how I look myself.
Yeah, we're supposed to be, and in theory are, working on a web series. We've been writing.
We shot one episode. And I think we learned a lot about character development. Like the thing that I learned, I mean, one of the things I learned from this book and applied was just that like, it's like always be writing. I think it's the whole page of one of these pages, like always be writing, always be writing. It's like the only thing it says. And it's just like you need to do it and you need to learn quick. And we gave ourselves that quick deadline and we made this project of these two guys doing this meditation podcast, basically.
Yeah. It was starring Chris and...
And Kenny Klein. Yeah. And...
Kenny Klein's a great name.
Oh, yeah. He sounds famous already. He is kind of famous a little bit. In certain industries.
The mattress industry. I'll just leave it at that.
It sounds like he's a porn star.
It does.
Maybe. Oh, Kenny, we love you. And we shot it. And the thing that I learned immediately from just shooting it, which I guess is like if you're listening and you do have an idea for something you want to make, writing and shooting within one weekend was like the way of just like seeing the characters like and learning so much about how the camera works. And
yeah, and sound, lessons. You know, and how shots can make something so much funnier.
I think it was
not
like,
alcohol shots, but like shots. Like not shots of alcohol.
Oh, shots of alcohol. Gotcha.
Yeah, like you know, camera shots.
Yeah, camera shots.
You can really play up the, you know, you can heighten the humor in a scene by shooting something a certain way.
I think it taught me like, yeah, like all those things, and those are all just like the things that you get to learn the things that you don't know like really quickly. You're like, I need to figure out, yeah, how to do sound better, like you said, you know, and you're like, oh, I should do that quickly.
Yeah, and. You know, lighting and I think we shot it with this idea that it would be like the first episode of this web series. And then when we looked at it, it kind of became we revised our narrative, our general narrative, which we're still revising. And we made a bet with some friends that we have to have 8 episodes out by December 31st.
Yeah, so
2015 or whoever loses has to.
Yeah, so I just told you that like right before we went on the air to record this. How do you feel about that? So just to like clue everybody in, so there's this one chapter in here about having a deadline, which I think kind of strikes, and it's like you must have a deadline. If you don't have a deadline, you're not writing for a living. You're writing as a hobby. So it talks about the importance of having a deadline.
Yeah.
And I think we all kind of recognize that because we've been talking about this so long. So, so myself and you, myself and Sid, I've given ourselves a deadline of December 31st to produce 8 episodes of this web series.
Well, what he really did was he made a bet with two other friends.
On your behalf.
Kenny and Lisa.
Yeah.
And they had things that they are on the table as well.
Yeah.
That they have to accomplish by that
date. It's a 3-person accountability. Yeah.
And if we lose, the losers have to stand in Times Square.
No, it's not Times Square, on Broadway, but close enough.
Oh, have to stand on Broadway naked for a 15-minute shoot in your underwear?
In your undies. Yeah, that's not naked. Is
but
that
it's going to be the middle of winter.
It's going to be January 1st that we have to do that if we don't complete this and get this done.
Oh, my God.
Are you up? I mean, I'm asking you right now, like, are you in?
We're so screwed.
That's the bet. Are you going to do this?
We're so screwed. Yeah, I guess I have to.
I mean, you don't have to.
My underwear's on the line.
We get to, the winners get to pick the loser's underwear.
Oh, that's right. That's a whole, that's an addendum.
Yeah. I think it has to be Teddy Whitey's, though. I think or something like, it can't just be like...
Well, the Naked Cowboy really sold Tidy Whitey's.
That's true.
To America. That's true. I think.
Yeah, so that's so
not
that's
Calvin Klein, not American Apparel, but the Naked Cowboy.
Yeah, I was thinking one episode in the web series we make. I was just thinking this a second ago, like it could, we could write in like a scene where there's people and they make a bet, and then if they lose, they have to go wear Tidy Whitey's on Broadway. And because Kenny's acting in it, even if he wins, he loses because then he has to act and be that person on Broadway.
Ooh. Oh, I'm sorry. Kenny Klein, if you're out
going
there.
Down.
You're going down, buddy.
That was one of my thoughts. Have you, and what's your experience? I mean, you've written a bunch and you have like a, you took a sketch writing course, and I know you at the UCB and or the Pit.
It was at the Pit.
Yeah.
I did. I took sketch writing and I've always been like a journaler.
Yeah.
And like write weird poetry and stuff like that. But What I think was really interesting was them talking about character development. That was something that was really
What about it?
Intriguing to me, because I think that it's quite difficult, or it's something that I hadn't had a ton of experience with.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of think that that's the basis. And Chris and I have talked about this much more recently. But if you have really, really well defined characters, then I think it makes the script writing process a lot easier. Yeah. And they say in the book that having an outline is like numero uno.
Oh yeah, that's an interesting point.
It's really important.
Yeah.
But to me, I think that like having really, really strong characters with a strong kind of story,
yeah,
or like they say, you know, your character should be a hero. They say, don't pussy around. Your hero needs to be a hero, which I thought was a really good quote.
Yeah.
Because they said, make him Han Solo likable, Indiana Jones likable, make him so goddamn likable that every single kid who sees your movie is going to wish he was your hero for the rest of his life.
Right.
Which also, I don't know. I want to touch upon how this book is kind of sexist, but
yeah,
because it's pretty much only geared towards men. It's like written for men.
I mean, they tell you
about
to,
men.
They tell you to, when you're doing well, they tell you to Google this chick's boobs, who I don't recognize her name, but
Yeah, they pretty much write it exclusively for, like, straight men.
It is basically for straight white men between the ages of, like, 18 and 35.
Because they just talk about how when you get rich, you'll marry a Victoria's Secret model.
Right.
And
right.
I'm like, well, I don't really want to marry a Victoria's
Secret
model.
No, you have to. That's what they do.
You have to? You get handed one?
Yeah. Try harder. Come on. You get handed one. Date her. Yeah, that's true. So yeah, the part you took away was about the character development. Yeah, it's funny. I think that's important. And the outline part really kind of hit me, which was like, I mean, like they're related, right? And it's something that we've been struggling with, right? Because whenever I write, I tend to write outlines of like the whole story. And I feel like when you write, Sid, you write, or like when we discuss it, a lot of times you're focused on the characters. The outline thing was cool, like, and you know, if you're listening and you've ever thought, hey, you know, maybe I want to like write an idea for a web series or a movie or just something for fun. They talk about how there is no, like, with quotes, like writing a screenplay. Like, you're not writing a screenplay. You're writing an outline first.
Right.
The idea is, and I think they have this chapter here
about writing with someone.
Yeah, about writing with someone, and this is something I think that like we should try maybe like right after this recording.
Yeah, it's about making the process of writing more efficient by writing with a partner and writing the outline together, and then sort of divvying it up and and then dividing and conquering, which I think is really interesting and could be cool for a web series,
right?
To like write like trade-off episodes or something, and then you get back together and you kind of review all the content and make it, punch it up, and
yeah exactly,
revise together.
Yeah. And it's like they say, they go to a bar or something like that. Yeah, you're right. So they look
a lot
at the
of drinking.
It says that, so they go
it's like
the girls,
look at some girls
look
at
some
the bar
girls, you know, drink some beers. And then they're like, they just knock out, they make it sound really easy. Like, we just knock out an outline, which is something like 15 pages of just like the story. And then the second step is they take it home, they flip a coin, and they do odds and evens on the pages. And then they separately go and they write the dialogue for that. And then they come back and bring it together.
Do you think they really do that?
I think so, yeah. Did you see the cover of the book?
It was sort of, yeah, it's a very silly cover, but that chapter was very short.
Yeah.
And it made me, and something about them saying that they go to the bar to write. just didn't seem real. But so they talk about advice for writing with a partner and mm-hmm. how this can make the scriptwriting process a lot faster nice. And a lot easier.
Right.
They say first write an outline of your movie, figure out the entire movie, and write it out in an in-depth outline. But this you need to do together.
Right. That makes sense.
But they have this kind of interesting listicle.
Yeah.
What makes something a listicle?
I think if it's a list, it's a listicle.
Really?
Yeah.
Our parents' generation would probably hate that.
Yeah,
that just sounds like something.
Just call it a list.
A list.
Idiots.
Yeah. Where's your pencil and a paper?
Yeah.
So it says, you and your partner must trust each other, one. Two, you must have the same sense of humor. Three, you must be egoless. Fight for something because it's good, not because you wrote it. And four, don't be a dick, which is great.
Which one of those do you think we need to work on the most?
I think that, you know, we need to work on your sense of humor.
Yeah, I think so. I think I just repeat and write down all the things you say and make myself sound really clever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think that we have enough experience yet.
That's not number five. They don't need to have experience.
I think that we need to actually write stuff.
Are you saying that we should be writing things and not talking on this podcast right now?
Yeah, we are doing literally everything to avoid
making this. We're like, let's make a documentary about us making a film so that we could do that.
Like, we're doing lots of things that make us feel productive, but ultimately we're not doing the one thing
that's true
that we keep saying that we're gonna do.
Yes, I did actually, that was truthful, tell Sydney about the bet literally before the mics went on. So she was a little bit like, oh, okay, we're part of this bet. Although afterwards, I gave her a chance to back out if she wanted to. She took a day to think about it and she signed. We all had to sign this little email and she's in. And we are going forth with having four episodes by the end of the new year. So we'll have those ready, or there will be some glam shots of myself and her in her underwear on Broadway, walking the catwalk, strutting our stuff, and I'm sure those will make that way onto the internet, because that's the way losing bets works. So you may have one or the other of those to look forward to this Christmas. Well, this new year, I suppose. On Books is brought to you by me and a microphone. If you like it and you're enjoying this, please subscribe on iTunes. It's free. It makes things feel good. Maybe write a review. Say, hey, I like this. It's good. Follow On Books on Twitter at On Books Show. My Twitter, my personal Twitter, is at Castig. That's C-A-S-T-I-G. Please subscribe to On Books on Facebook, facebook.com/On Books Show. We're not on Instagram, but maybe I am, but whatevs. Okay, so those are a bunch of different ways you can get in touch. You get it. My name is Chris Castiglione. Episode editor is Gabrielle Urbina. This music and some other songs in here were from Birdstar. The opening track is a Knife Joanna Newsom remix, and that was done by Taylor Bentz. Thanks again for listening. I'm going to play us out with the end of the commercial, or the trailer, let's say, for the book by Rob and Tom. So you'll hear that at the end. Thanks again for listening. Adios, adios, adios. Bye.
And how much would you expect to pay for those incredible secrets?
$1 billion?
This amazing book can be all yours for just $23.99.
That's like $1 million off. Remember, every moment that you're not writing screenplays, you're missing out on money, cash, vacations, real estate, drugs, all the other wonderful things that you can buy with money. So what the fuck are you waiting for?
Oh, we're writing movies for a profit today!
I did.
I did.
I did too.
And earn millions the old-fashioned way.
In Hollywood.
Fact, technically, screenwriting may lead to headaches, backaches, carpal tunnel syndrome, narcolepsy, depression, anxiety, insomnia, divorce, suicide, and substance abuse.
Booze is like chugging a glass full of ideas.
So what are you waiting for, jackass? Pull your head out of the bong and start living the high life
with writing movies for fun and profit.
Order yours today.
Give me your best book report. Go.
This book was very good. The two writers, Robert and Thomas, did a really good job writing it. And when they wrote the book, it showed me that they loved to write because they wrote a book, but they talked about writing in the book. And P.S., you'll become an alcoholic